Good morning, and the Lord be with you. I welcome all of you today once again as we gather virtually on this wonderful Sunday morning. We have something wonderful to share and proclaim and celebrate today. We celebrate the love of God made real to us through his one and only Son, Jesus Christ. We fix our eyes on Jesus and know that all of our sins are forgiven and know that life with God is indeed life forever. Of course, over the course of the next 50 minutes or so, you'll hear a lot about Jesus. Of course, we're looking forward to hearing the good news of life with God through Jesus Christ. But before we continue, just a couple of items I want to point out to you. We have some big happenings at the church in the days ahead. We have virtual Bible study on Thursdays. That continues Thursday evenings at 7:15 p.m. It's the Gospel of John. If you'd like to be included in that, reach out to the church. The contact information is appearing in the comments right now. We'd love for you to join us for that. Of course, in-person worship continues wherever you're at, whatever you're most comfortable doing, whether it's worshiping at home virtually or if you'd like to come in person sometime. We have opportunities Saturday nights, 5:30 p.m., which is indoors, a contemporary service. You need a reservation for that. And, of course, Sunday mornings at 8:30 and 11, those are outdoors, weather pending. We'd love to see you. And once again, if you're comfortable, if you're able. Speaking of which, we have a big event coming up Sunday, November 1st, after the 11 o'clock worship service. So 12:15 is the scheduled start time. We're having our fall festival. That's an event designed for children and for families. And a lot of great activities are planned for families. We'd love to have you join us for that. As always, it will be outdoors. It will be safe. It will be socially distanced. Our staff is working very hard to have a very, very safe event where everyone feels welcome and everyone feels comfortable. You'll get details about that in emails and all the correspondence, of course, that the church sends out. I want to thank our helpers today, as always. I thank Deacon Michelle, who's helping with the service, both with the spoken part of the service and with the technological aspects of the service. She's bringing the service into your homes today, onto your devices today. We thank God for all that she does, all that she's done over the course of these past many months now. We thank Diana Auer, who's helping with the service today, as always, with the children's sermon, with the music as well. Our amazing minister of music, Mr. Edward Detling Jr., playing the organ, playing the piano today. And our special guest chancel assistant today is a member of our Saturday worship group. Her name is Tiffany Smitelli. Rumor has it she's a pretty good singer. So I'm just going to give you a heads up. You should have high expectations for the church music at the course of this service today. So we're looking forward to a wonderful time together worshiping Jesus Christ as our service begins with the confession and absolution. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins to God our Father, imploring him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. Almighty God, our Maker and Redeemer, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean, and that we have sinned against you by thought, word, and deed. Wherefore, we flee for refuge to your infinite mercy, seeking and imploring your grace for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. O most merciful God, who has given your only begotten Son to die for us, have mercy upon us, and for his sake, grant us forgiveness of all our sins, and by your Holy Spirit, increase in us true knowledge of you and of your will, and true obedience to your word, to the end that by your grace we may come to everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, has had mercy upon us and has given his only Son, Jesus Christ, to die for us, and for Jesus' sake, forgives us all of our sins. I announce the grace of God and declare to you the entire forgiveness of all of your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We join together and sing our opening hymn, Amazing Grace.
Be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, the protector of all who trust in you, have mercy on us, that you, as our ruler and guide, we may pass through things temporal, that we may not lose the things eternal. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The first reading is from the book of Isaiah. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then shall the lame man leap like a deer, and the tongue of the mute sing for joy. For waters break forth in the wilderness, and streams in the desert. The burning sand shall become a pool, and the thirsty ground springs of water. In the haunt of jackals, where they lie down, the grass shall become reeds and rushes. And a highway shall be there, and it shall be called the Way of Holiness. The unclean shall not pass over it. It shall belong to those who walk on the way. Even if they are fools, they shall not go astray. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The book of Psalms. O sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth.
Sing to the Lord, bless his name.
tell of his salvation from day to day.
Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among all the peoples.
For great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods.
For all the gods of the peoples are worthless idols, but the Lord made the heavens.
Splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary.
Ascribe to the Lord, O families of the peoples, ascribe to the Lord glory and strength.
Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts.
Worship the Lord in the splendor of holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth.
Glory be to the Father,
and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
The epistle reading is from 2 Timothy chapter 4. As for you, always be sober-minded, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry, for I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have loved his appearing. Do your best to come to me, for Demas, in love with this present world, has deserted me and gone to Thessalonica. Crescens has gone to Galatia, Titus to Dalmatia. Luke alone is with me. Get Mark and bring him with you, for he is very useful to me for ministry. Tychicus I have sent to Ephesus. When you come, bring the cloak that I left with Carpus at Troas, also the books, above all the parchments. Alexander the coppersmith did me great harm. The Lord will repay him according to his deeds. Beware of him yourself, for he is strongly opposed to our message. At my first defense, no one came to stand beside me, but all deserted me. May it not be charged against them. But the Lord stood by me and strengthened me, so that through me the message might be fully proclaimed and all the Gentiles might hear it. So I was rescued from the lion's mouth. The Lord will rescue me from every evil deed and bring me safely into his heavenly kingdom. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. These things are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 22nd chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
Then the Pharisees went and plotted how to entangle Jesus in his talk. And they sent their disciples to him, along with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are true and teach the way of God truthfully, and you do not care about anyone's opinion, for you are not swayed by appearances. Tell us then what you think. Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not?" But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, "Why put me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin for the tax." And they brought him a denarius. And Jesus said to them, "Whose likeness and inscription is this?" They said, "Caesar's." Then he said to them, "Therefore, render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's." When they heard it, they marveled, and they left him and went away. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Good morning, grown-ups. Welcome back on another beautiful Sunday morning. I am so thrilled to be here with you again to talk about Jesus. Now, boys and girls, I want you to think back. Was there ever a time when you were outside on a bright, sunny day and you saw the sun reflect off of something shiny, like maybe the hood of a car or maybe a big metal slide on a playground? And boys and girls, it was really bright, wasn't it? Almost blinding, it was so bright. But you weren't looking directly at the sun. You were looking at a reflection of the light. Or, I have something with me today. For example, this flashlight, right? The flashlight has light. And if I were to put the flashlight up to the mirror, if you were here, you would see the light is reflected off of the wall. But again, we're not looking directly at the flashlight, we're looking at a reflection of the light. And boys and girls, reflections are really cool, right? Because we're not looking directly at the source of the light, but we're still seeing it. Now, boys and girls, what are some sources of light in your life? Well, we talked about one already, right? The sun in the sky. The sun in the sky provides light, and it is a source of light. We see it reflected as light. But what about a different kind of sun? An S-O-N. Jesus, right? Jesus is the Son of God, and Jesus is certainly a source of light in our life. And Jesus even said so in the Gospel of John. Jesus says, "I am the light of the world." And he sure is. Jesus shines his light in the darkness to make the world a brighter place. And Jesus spreads that light all over the world to take us out of darkness. But boys and girls, just like that mirror, Jesus wants us to be a reflection of that light. Jesus wants us to spread that light to everyone we meet. And Jesus wants us, through our actions and our behaviors, to be a reflection of that light. And Jesus wants us to be a reminder to all people that there are good things to come. So boys and girls, sometimes life will get hard, and sometimes it might feel like we're surrounded by darkness. But Jesus makes that promise to us that he will always be there for us, and he will always be the light in the darkness. So boys and girls, remember, always look towards the light, look towards Jesus, because no one ever hurt their eyes by looking on the bright side. Amen? Great job, boys and girls. Let's fold our hands and bow our heads, and we're going to do a rhyming prayer today. So repeat after me. Thank you, Jesus, for your light.
Thank you, Jesus, for your light.
Help it shine in us so bright.
Help it shine in us so bright.
Let your love show me the way. To be a blessing every day.
To be a blessing every day.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Great job, boys and girls. We miss you and we're praying for you, and we can't wait to see you so soon. Our service continues now with our hymn of the day.
Beautiful Savior, King.
true or false, it's always great looking at old pictures of yourself. That's one of those statements that maybe is sometimes true and sometimes very false. This past week, I was looking at some pictures of myself that were 25 years old, which, if you don't know, that would put me in late college years. And to put it bluntly, it was a sobering experience. I'd not seen the pictures for a while. I'd not seen myself 25 years ago for a while, but I looked at these pictures, and the person I was looking at these pictures looks quite different than the person I look at in the mirror every morning. And that's one of the things about life, I suppose. You know, you're living life, you're living day to day, you're doing what you have to do, you're going about your routines, you're trying to do your job, you're trying just to make it through that day. You're minding your own business, if you take my meaning. And then all of a sudden, like a bolt of lightning, you have a moment of mortality. A moment where you can't help but ask, what's happened? What's happening? I'll give you some examples. Let's say, for example, you want to throw the football with your children. And you take the football, you take your kids, you go outside, you say, hey kids, go deep. And they go deep, and you throw that football, and the football doesn't go deep. It goes like medium. I asked the staff earlier, every moment's like this, and they said, yes, well, we try and do cartwheels. Yeah. Moments of mortality. Another example, you get word from a friend from college that he is now a grandfather. Or you go to the doctor for standard age-appropriate tests. Or you find out you have something. Or your friend has something. Or someone you know, someone close to you, someone who's always been there, passes away. These moments where you have to face the great reality that life in this world isn't going to last forever, that we're only here for a short time. And I wish I could tell you not to worry about it. I wish I could tell you it's all in your head, but the thing is, I can't because it's not. Mortality is a real thing. Our time is limited, and our time is getting shorter by the day. We're not always going to be here. And I'm sorry if this is like a bolt of lightning for some of you. I'm sorry if you were looking to hear about something else today, but this is the topic. And it's something human beings have to come to terms with. The last couple of months or so, my wife and I have been working on a will. And most of you know what a will is, but anyway, I'll explain it again. A will is essentially a document that outlines what is supposed to happen when we're no longer here. What's supposed to happen after we're gone. And there's all kinds of practical considerations, all kinds of pragmatic things you got to think about and talk about. It's been a really odd and eye-opening experience for us. And of course, for us right now, as we write this document, as we try and come up with a plan of what would happen after we're gone. And folks, let me just say this. We're planning to be here for a while. The plan is to be here a long, long time, many, many years, but you have to make plans like this. And the biggest consideration for us, of course, is our children. And a lot of practical considerations about bills and college and who would care for them if something did happen. But aside from all those practical considerations, for us, for my wife and I, as we've considered this these past couple of months, the biggest issue for us, the biggest consideration for us is this. After we're gone, we want our children, those who follow us, to know and to believe and to have the historic biblical Christian faith. What's most important, faith and knowledge of the death and resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the comfort and assurance of forgiveness of sins and life everlasting through Jesus Christ. There's no ifs, ands, buts about it. Jesus is most important. What do you want to happen after you're gone? Well, that. Find comfort in Jesus. And I'm sorry to talk about this sobering topic today, but this sobering topic very much ties in with our second reading from Paul's second letter to Timothy. And I think at this point, a lot of you know a lot about this man, St. Paul. He was an evangelist. He was a church leader. He proclaimed the good news of Jesus Christ throughout much of the ancient Roman world. He wrote much, of your New Testament. And if you know anything about his life, he spent some time in prison. He had a couple of different stints in various prisons, and his prison experiences ranged from kind of softer to kind of very hard. Like, he spent some time in a Roman prison, but it was really a house. He was under house arrest. And he lived in a house, and he ate normal food, and he was treated well, and he was allowed to have visitors. Whoever wanted to come could come and visit Paul in his house arrest under his prison. So it really is like a church. It was really more of a quarantine situation, which we all can relate with, I think, right? So he had that. But he also had a very hard experience. The more classic, typical prison experience that I think we all associate with when we hear that word prison. And that's the context for this second reading. Paul writes this letter from a place called Mamertine Prison. And it was in Rome. And from history, we know a bit about this prison. I've actually visited the site of this prison. And it's kind of underground, kind of a basement kind of situation. Not a lot of lighting, not a lot of air. And history tells us it was notoriously a hard place, a brutal place. And of course, it bears mentioning that Paul was in prison, not because he committed a crime as we would label it. He was in prison for doing what we do, for sharing Jesus Christ, for doing the work of the church. Back in the day, the height of the Roman Empire, they weren't big fans of Jesus. They weren't big fans of the work of the church. Doing the work of the church could land you in a brutal prison. And that's where Paul was, Mamertine Prison. And from history, we also know Mamertine Prison was the place often where prisoners would be as they awaited the execution of the death sentence. Mamertine Prison was like death row. And that's why Paul was there. He had been convicted. He was awaiting his death sentence. Talk about a moment of mortality. Talk about staring death in the face. And Paul, realizing this, was very concerned about what was going to happen after he was gone. So he writes this letter to his colleague, to his protege, a man named Timothy. And it functions very much as a last will and testament. If you ever read 2 Timothy, it kind of works like that. And this is what he writes to his friend, his colleague, his protege, Timothy. As for you, always be sober-minded. Endure suffering. Do the work of an evangelist. Fulfill your ministry. In other words, this work that we're doing, this proclamation of Jesus Christ, this is imperative. This is important. You got to keep after it. You got to do it. I'm not always going to be here. But the world keeps spinning. And the world still needs Jesus. The world will always need Jesus. You keep after it. You do what you're supposed to do. You be who you're supposed to be. You be about the work that we have done together. And then Paul gets reflective as he continues. For I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have loved his appearing. Words of a man facing the end, facing his own mortality, thinking about what's going to happen after he's gone. And his words reach down to each of us through the ages. From this reading, we glean two things that will happen when we're no longer here, after we're gone. The first thing is this: though you will no longer be here, you will be somewhere. And that somewhere means everything. When you are no longer here, you will receive the fullness of what God has promised you through Jesus Christ. When your time on this earth is over, Jesus shares a perfect hope with us. In John chapter 14, Jesus says, "In my Father's house, there are many rooms, and I go there to prepare a place for you." When your time on this earth is over, life with God continues. Because life with God is forever. Because Jesus Christ died on a cross to fix what was broken about humanity, to overcome the ultimate challenge of mortality. We're only human. We're flawed. We're imperfect. Well, on that cross, Jesus changed that. Or he addressed that. A better way to say it. Because on that cross, Jesus sacrificed himself to take away your sin. To replace that sin, that flaw, that brokenness with forgiveness. Perpetual forgiveness. Ongoing forgiveness. All of your sins are forgiven. And then Jesus Christ rose from the dead to give you everlasting life. To go to heaven itself. And to get your place ready. No, life is so uncertain. I mean, we're in the midst of that right now, aren't we? Life is so uncertain, it often doesn't go the way you want. But in the midst of all that uncertainty, there's something we always know: resurrection. Life everlasting. When our time in this world is over, we will be with God. We will be with all those who have gone before us. We will see each other again. No more pain, no more grief, no more tears, no more suffering, no more death. It's going to get better. Wherever you are at in your life, if things are wonderful, if things are challenging, it's going to get better. Because Jesus Christ died on that cross and rose again to overcome mortality and to replace mortality with to place mortality with immortality. That's what happens once you're gone. At least the first thing. The second thing, just like it did for St. Paul, once we're no longer here, the world will keep spinning. People will come after us. People will replace us. It is imperative that we lay the groundwork for the message of Jesus to be continued, to be proclaimed to the next generation, to the next generation, to the next generation. Brothers and sisters, friends in Christ, parents, grandparents, fellow church members, the world is bigger than us. Time is bigger than us. The challenge is bigger than us. But thanks be to God for the gift of the Holy Spirit. Thanks be to God for the life-saving message of Jesus Christ. Take time this week. Make a point to share that message with your children, with your grandchildren, with those who come after you. Support the ongoing work of the church. And I apologize if this seems like a self-serving point, but here we are. One of the fundamental beliefs of this church, one of the fundamental ways we practice our Christianity, is we emphasize Sunday school, youth, children, families. Because part of life in the kingdom of God is looking forward, is doing all that we can to ensure the continued proclamation of Jesus Christ. So, brothers and sisters, friends in Christ, who's your Timothy? Think about that. Think about that today. Think about that in the weeks to come. Who can I pass my faith on to? Because, my friends, the nicest thing, the most wonderful thing you can ever do for another human being is to share life. Brothers and sisters, friends in Christ, share the gift of life. Share Jesus Christ. In his name, for his sake, amen. I invite you to join me now as we confess the ancient Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. Please stand. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And I do once again invite you, if you're in a position to do so right now, to consider offering financial support for your offering to the ongoing work of the church here in this place and throughout the world. in the comment section right now. Some instructions are appearing on how you can make an online donation. You can also send your donations directly to the church. As always, I remain available to discuss this matter or anything pertaining to the ministry of the Lutheran Church of the Resurrection. All of that being said, our service continues as we listen to the offertory.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. And nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate?
Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Almighty God, daily your mercies grant us everlasting forgiveness and goodness. Teach us to trust not in our own works, but in your word for steadfast endurance in time of test, trial, and tribulation. Renew our lives of prayer and devotion that we may remain constant and immovable in faith through Christ Jesus, your Son. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious Father, open the eyes of the blind by the light of your word, and open the ears of the deaf with the voice of your gospel, to clear the way for all people to know the riches of your grace and the gift of forgiveness and the promises of life everlasting in Christ. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Receive our thanks, O Lord, for the greatness of your creation, and help us to be good stewards of your provisions by faithful and wise use of all your gifts, that we may honor you with our words and our works in service to our families, neighbors, and communities. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, bless our nation with peace and harmony, and grant wisdom to all those whom you have placed in temporal authority, both in this country and throughout the world. Bless our president, our governor, and all legislators and judges, and renew their diligence that they would use their offices to serve their fellow citizens with justice and compassion. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful Lord, lift up and strengthen all those who serve as doctors and nurses, all medical researchers, and those who work to end disease, and for all those who care for people most vulnerable. We pray also for your continued protection and blessing to all those who serve in the military, all police officers, firefighters, and all first responders. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Eternal Father, we bring before you in prayer all those suffering any physical or mental anguish. Give healing to the sick, relief to those who are suffering, and grant comfort and peace to those who are in mourning. We do pray especially for all those listed on our prayer guide and all those we name in our hearts now. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, as we receive the gifts of forgiveness, life, and salvation given to us by your Son through the means of grace, fill us with your life and love, so that we may share those gifts with others. Strengthen us by your Spirit, that we may endure to the day when we shall be reunited together with all the saints to receive the crown of righteousness from you and live in your eternal presence without end. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands, O God, we place ourselves and our prayers, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Amen.
And Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And the peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and grant you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We join together and sing our final song, In Christ Alone.
When fears are stilled, when striving ceases. precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my death.
Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.